Anyway, let's turn in our Bibles to Genesis chapter 28 this morning. Genesis chapter 28. I want to talk about something today that we're familiar with, and yet maybe have not really embraced the power and the ability that God has given to us through prayer, because it actually releases the armies of the Lord on our behalf. And I just want to start reading in Genesis chapter 28, starting to read at verse 10. And as we're reading this, we find a man who's at the point in his life where from a very early age, he wanted to serve the Lord, and there was just words and dreams that were inside of his heart. And then God took that young man through a process over the course of time. His name was Jacob. And he had worked 7 years for a wife, and his father-in-law tricked him and gave him the first wife, and then he agreed to work another 7 years to get a second wife. Kind of a completely different cultural mindset, right, than we have today. But he served the Lord, but there was just stuff inside of his life, stuff inside of his heart. And we've all got stuff. And from the beginning of when the Lord calls us to when the Lord begins to allow there to be this momentum, there is usually this period. And it can last. It can last a long time. Where God prepares us to be able to carry his purpose and plan. And then what we find out is that God brings us into a place where everything bad that's happened, as well as everything good, can all come together in a convergence to where we begin to look back upon our lives and say, God, thank you, man. Not just for the good, but also for the bad, and he begins to bring the pieces of the puzzle together. And so we have this man, his name is Jacob, and life has caught up with him. He really did his brother dirty, if you would. And it's been years since he has seen him. He cheated his brother out of his inheritance. And now we're looking to him just days before a confrontation with his brother, and he has no idea what kind of mindset his brother's going to be in. So in Genesis chapter 28, we find this man just looking for the glory of the Lord and the presence of the Lord to begin to be demonstrated in his life in this process. And I'm sorry, let's start reading at verse, Genesis chapter 28, verse 10. Then Jacob departed from Beersheba and went toward Haran. He came to a certain place and spent the night there because the sun had set. And he took one of the stones of the place and put it under his head and lay down in that place. He had a dream, and behold, a ladder was set on the earth with its top reaching to heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord your God, the Father, Lord, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give it to you and to your descendants. Your descendants will also be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south, and in you and in your descendants shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, for the word of the Lord. I thank you, Lord God, for this man's experience at Bethel that became the house of the Lord in his life. I thank you, Father, that you gave him a series of visitations to reveal to him, Lord, that you're going to bring forth your purpose in his life. So I pray, Father, that you would come and bless this word to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As we're looking at this passage right here, Jacob is a man who wants to fulfill his purpose and destiny, and he's going to have some encounters. But God's got to give to him a revelation of how this whole thing is going to work. I want to guarantee us today that God has called us to do something which in the natural we cannot accomplish on our own. God wants to hand to us a lifestyle where we will learn to trust him and become dependent upon him for everything. This man now is going to enter into a series of events that are going to change the course of his life. In some ways, it feels as though it's completely outside of his control, and it's the activity of God that's working in him. This man is just wanting to find out what his purpose and his destiny is, and God's about to speak it to him. And God's going to let him know that he is going to fulfill his promise that he gave to his grandfather and his father, and that God was going to give to him the nation of Israel. And that in that place, wherever he would place his foot, that God would bless him. I want us to begin to think today that God has a life for us, that we begin to walk, and that wherever we go, we experience the release of the blessing of God in our lives. And that we actually see that as we're going through our jobs, as we're stepping on a bus, as we're going to the grocery store, as you're going to the shooting range, wherever you might be going, that you're going to realize that the presence of God is saying, I'm giving you this ground, I'm giving you this ground. This is yours, this is yours. Be open to me. I'm working mightily on your behalf. I'm working in your life. And so that you begin to go through life and just you're just saying to yourself, man, I've got a calling, a destiny, and a territory to claim for God. And so he gets this revelation inside of his heart, right? It's building in him. God's got to get rid of a lot of the junk in his life, but God's big enough to do that. And as he's in this place, God gives him a revelation that comes with the word of the Lord. And what is the revelation that God gives to him when he's realizing his destiny? God gives him a vision of angels ascending and descending like a ladder over his life. So as he sees this ladder that is set up, he is beginning to see that there are powerful beings that reside in heaven and reside in the presence of God, and they come down to the earth and they touch his ground and touch his place, and then they ascend back up to God. And he gets this awareness of angelic activity that's in his life. And when we become aware that God is saying to us, I have ministering spirits that are here on your behalf, there's going to be a ladder that is set up over your life that if you will see and walk in the power that I am providing for you, because you are men and women that are coming into the kingdom blessing of God, you will begin to understand you're not out there on your own. You are not trying to figure everything out. You can actually live a lifestyle of the expectation of divine appointments that God is going to set before you. You can expect provision to do anything that God has called you to do. You can expect God to send his angels to stop enemies who want to come against you and hinder you from fulfilling what God wants you to do. The angels that are ascending and descending over our lives, as we see here in this vision that was given to Jacob, is an indication to us that we're to change the way we pray and begin to believe that with God all things are possible. And that we're to begin to understand as well that I can be praying right here and God can be doing something on the other side of the planet in answer to my prayers. I don't need to be there. I don't need to know what's going on there. I don't need to have the money to get there. And yet when I hit my knees, I realize that there are the release of heaven's hosts in my life to do anything. How many times do we step out and just saying, how should I pray? Well, let's not ask for too much. Let's ask within the context of whether I'm there or whether I have enough. What if we begin to just pray and think, oh, God, listen, that moment is already passed, or that opportunity hasn't happened. It's not going to be able to happen. And yet, what if we began to believe that there is a realm in which God says, I can do anything that you ask me in the name of Jesus. Anything. Absolutely anything. And you have armies backing you up. Can you imagine if we shifted our mindset and we began to say to ourselves, or we began to dream, if we began to dream in the context that we have a whole army of heaven that can do anything that we ask the Father. Maybe, is it possible that a dreaming would get a whole lot bigger, right? And so Jacob here receives the vision of the Lord. He's just one man. But by the provision of the Lord and the release of the understanding that God can do anything, God's going to be able to deal with his brother when he comes into the confrontation with his brother. God's going to be able to get him the wife that he needs. He's going to be able to actually give him two wives. He wasn't expecting that. And out of that is going to come 12 descendants, which will be the 12 leaders of the tribe of Jacob. And we're finding that this man, see, by the release of the revelation that God can do anything, this man just began to step out and live for the Lord and then watch things unfold in his life. This was a man that was given this promise concerning an earthly nation that God was going to build, a promise to the nation of Israel. But we need to begin to understand that God has given to us the earth. He's given us the world. Jesus said to us, go into all the world. We're to carry the promise that was given to Jesus, where it says concerning the Messiah, ask me for nations, and I will give them to you as your inheritance. Who is asking for the nations? Jesus said to his disciples, just simple fishermen, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go you therefore and teach what? All nations. Do we understand that we could wake up on a Saturday morning and we can lie in bed and that we can rule the nations? Do we begin to understand that a man or a woman who really begins to embrace the faith of the God who can do the impossible, that we could sit and we could pray for the king of Saudi Arabia? We can pray for the prime minister of Israel. We can pray for what's going on in North Korea. But a lot of times we don't think within those contexts because we think with limited mindsets. And yet I want us to understand that all of heaven is poised to answer the prayers of the saints. All of heaven is waiting for the people who are going to say, kingdom of God come and will of God be done on earth as it is in heaven. Who really prays that prayer with faith? It's the men and women who believe that when they speak the word of the Lord, when they speak the promises of God, that with them it's impossible, but with God all things are possible. And you can ask, you can actually invite an angelic presence to go into the bedroom of a king. If you and I will believe that God is, that with him all things are possible, and that the presence of the Lord can go and invade that place. But can you imagine if we began to, what our prayer closet would look like if we went in there? How many times do we hear about a war that's going on? A war that might be happening on the other side of the planet. And yet you know what? The body of Christ doesn't seem like we've really understood that we could actually mobilize the armies of heaven. That we could come together in a prayer of agreement. We could ask God to come and move upon artilleries and move upon soldiers and move upon the weather and move on all different kinds of things where we could say, God, we pray that you will do whatever it takes and release your angels, God, to bring peace to that situation and cause, God, that the conflict would come to nothing. Because it comes by the revelation of a ladder that's over our lives. God has embraced for himself the name of Jehovah, Jehovah Sabaoth. What does that mean? It means the Lord of the armies. He's called the captain of the hosts. Why did he bring that revelation to us? We can walk into our office place and we can actually say, we don't talk to our angels. The angels are beholding the face of God to answer his bidding. What does God bid them to do? God bids them to answer the prayers of the saints. I love that. I love just the idea that in heaven there are angels, it says, constantly beholding the face of God. And they're just looking at him. What are they waiting for? They're waiting for instructions. God, tell us what to do. God, what do you want us to do? You just, with that word there that's used for beholding the face of God, it means they are intently looking at him. Maybe, and to put it in human terms, okay? Maybe looking for the slightest twitch where they can go, oh yeah, someone's praying right now. We're about to get released. Because the people of God understand that when they say, kingdom of God come, they're calling down the angels of the Lord. Amen. And will of God be done on earth as it is in heaven. When we think about the angels of the Lord, we have to understand that this is part of the inheritance of the believer. When I gave my heart to Jesus Christ, I received an inheritance. An inheritance that was bought and paid for by the firstborn Son of God, the one who lived among us. Jesus earned from God the Father all authority, all kingdom, all power, everything for the advancement of the kingdom of God, that the powers of darkness might be brought down, were given to Jesus. And that authority was given to us. And God has told us, this is your inheritance. This is rightfully yours. God is calling us to an increase of an awareness of the inheritance. The Apostle Paul said that in Ephesians chapter 2. I pray that the eyes of your heart would be enlightened, that you might know the hope of your calling. What happened with Jacob here? Here's God said to him, I'm going to give you every place your foot would tread. I'm going to give to you the promises. That's, he understood the hope of the calling. And then God says, I'm going to show you the riches of the glory of the inheritance. God is saying, what Jesus bought and paid for you and for me is a glorious thing, backed up with the powers of heaven. You and I are to live daily conscious of the fact that Jesus bought and paid for us the right to expect that there are ministering angels that are going to be sent on behalf of the answer of our prayers. And then he says that you might know the resurrection power, the same power that raised Christ from the dead. Here's three things that God wants to do for your life. And I guarantee you, for most of you, you've already heard it, or there's been stirring in your hearts. The first thing God says, I want you to know the will I have for your life. Next thing I want you to know is every inheritance that you have, the power of the angels and the provisions of God and the expectation of divine appointments that are going to be set up for you. And that the third thing I'm going to give to you, because of the release of the power of the angels, you will see the power of the resurrection going and backing up whatever you are calling down from heaven to earth. It's astounding to us when we think about it. When I think about Jesus, when we think about his life, what was his life like? After 400 years where we find out that it felt like heaven was quiet. Nothing was going on. And then what happens? Boom. An angel visits Mary. Then what happens? Boom. An angel visits Joseph. Now we haven't, this stuff isn't going on, right? Then what's the next thing that happens? Boom. And an angel comes to Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist. Then what happens? Jesus is born, and boom, what happens? Angels are filling the sky and declaring glory to God in the highest. And then what happens? Jesus grows up and he launches into his ministry. The call was there, but it was a 33-year-old process, a 30-year-old process. We're all in process here. But the process includes coming to then the experience of the angels beginning to be active in our lives. I really believe that God wants to bring an awakening and a revelation to each one of our hearts. And maybe it's going to happen today, because it happened to Jesus that when he was baptized, he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. And the devil was the one who came against him in that place and tempted him. And Jesus was made aware, hey, you know what? There is a spiritual battle to rob me of everything that God wants me to have. I have a call on my life. And I want to move forward in it. And I've been baptized. And the Spirit of God is leading me. And then in the leading of the Holy Spirit, suddenly the devil comes against him. And what does he try to do? Rob him of his destiny. And so Jesus was made aware of the fact, hey, you know what? I'm not in a natural battle. I'm in a spiritual battle. I'm in a spiritual battle for the call of God upon my life. And if I understand that I'm in a spiritual battle, then I realize I have to have spiritual ministering angels released into my life to help me in this process of coming into the fullness of my destiny. And so Satan comes and he tempts him three times. And Jesus puts him off with the word. And then what happens? The angels come in. It says that the angels came and they nourished him and strengthened him and fed him. It's so amazing to me that God wants us to begin to understand that even Jesus needed the ministering spirits of heaven, the angels themselves created by God, that when we have been completely diminished, they will, sorry for the swoop in term, but they will swoop in. And they will elevate our hearts and strengthen us in a time of need. And that's what God wants us to do. God's saying, don't do this on your own. Even the Son of God didn't do it on his own. And then as I think about the fact that Jesus was so... I will say that, you know, when I was young and I first went into the ministry, and I was like, you'd listen to your senior pastor, and he would talk much about, wow, it just felt like the devil came in and did this, and the devil came in and did that, and... A lot of times I think, well, you know, how much is the devil and how much isn't the devil? And I just don't want us to begin to see the devil around every corner. But I will say this. The longer you do, the longer you minister, you more you realize that there are actually things that cannot be coincidental, where there is a battle for everything you want to do for the Lord. I mean, last Sunday, for instance, you know, like, that was so important to me personally. And listen, I'm talking out of my own heart, because I just want you to know how important last week was for me, all right? You have to understand, at 22 years old, the first time I went to Israel, it was my first Hebrew class. And then, you know, I went back, that was in 81. In 86, I went back for a year, then took a Hebrew Ulpan for new immigrants and took that class. God birthed in my heart a love and a passionate desire for the Jewish people, and that we would stand on their behalf. And I just, there were so many things that came into my life over the years to make me conscious and aware of what happened to the Jewish people. I went on a missions trip once, and unexpected to me, I was taken to two concentration camps. There was all these pieces that were put into my life that I didn't understand. And they're, you know what? They're like 36 years old, some of this stuff. It's 36 years old that actually I didn't understand that, like, from the point of the call and what God begins to stir in your life, then there's a process of getting you, like, just to be a nicer person. Less sin, less attitude, less pride, less junk. Tons of junk. I'm just telling. And I'm not particularly filled with junk. You're all filled with junk. But I was aware of my junk. And my junk, I'm more overwhelmed with. And then the process of God getting the junk out of your life. And so last week, just telling you, just so you know, you were able to be a witness to God. I'm like, you have to understand, this last week was like one of the best weeks of my life. Why was that? Only because God took something from 22 years old and put it in this week. Then he took something at 26 years old and put it in this week. Took two visits to concentration camps at 33 years old, and he stuck it into this one week. You understand what I'm saying? And so, I don't want to over-spiritualize. But last week when we got in here, the whole set, we invited people to present their documentary and what goes down. The whole ability to play the documentary, right? I was so unpleasant last Sunday morning. Like, inside, I looked nice. I was not nice by any stretch of the imagination. You know, sometimes you find yourself in a situation, so if you've waited for something for 36 years, and then suddenly it's about to happen, you want everything to be right. You know what I'm saying? And nothing was going right. Actually, there was one man that was here that was visiting, and I got to talk to him this week, and he says, "Hey man, I was up there in your booth, and I thought that documentary's not going to happen." You know, he was traveling with us, and he said to me, "Man, when that video came on, you almost made a believer out of me." So, here's the whole thing, okay? So, but you know, I'm telling you, if any of you saw me, I was going into the cry room, I was praying and crying, and, "Oh God, please, you know, please let this thing happen." But I'm just telling you, it's those kind of things that you realize that there is a strategic enemy that is always trying to just mess up what you want to do before the Lord. I don't say that to make you scared. Don't panic. Don't say, "Oh no, I'm not going to step out of what God wants me to do, because if I do, I'm afraid of the spiritual attack." We just become aware of this thing with the understanding that the scripture says that greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. Amen. So we don't go into a panic, like I did last week. But I prayerfully panicked, okay? And God, you know, came and helped us. And some of you were the means by which God brought that miracle for us too. I mean, he's working in people's lives. And so, when we realize this, is, I just want to say this, from when I started to this point right now, I am so much more aware that in everything I want to do, there's something that wants to take it from me. But there is a ladder that's over my life that I can invite the armies of God. And, you know, it's like God saying, just begin to believe for my backing up your prayers. So, in John chapter 12, and by the way, let me just say, to have, I don't know, we were somewhere between 80 and 90 that went to the synagogue last Friday night. I just want to thank all of you for, like, being a part of the dream. Seriously, I'm just, it was wonderful. They were so blessed by you. It says, I don't like to talk about me. I just did for 5 minutes, right? In John chapter 12, in verse 27, now my soul has been troubled. What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came out of heaven. I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. So the crowd of people who stood by and heard it were saying that it had thundered. Others were saying an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered and said, this voice has not come for my sake, but for your sake. Now judgment is upon this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. Jesus is saying what I am. There is an enemy. How did he know there was an enemy? Because at the very beginning of the launching of his ministry, that enemy came in and tried to rob him of his destiny and purpose. He had had some revelations of angels, and yet God was going to unfold. This is going to be the days of the angelic release upon the earth. Jesus came to release angelic invitation on the earth, not just to a few heroes like we see in the Old Testament that fulfilled God's purpose for the nation of Israel, but Jesus is helping us to understand here, I came against the power of darkness, the angels came and ministered to me, and I want to assure you, my disciples, that I am, God just spoke a word over me from heaven. And the Lord, and the Father said, I have glorified you and I will glorify you again. In other words, what you came to do will be fulfilled. And I want to, I'm not saying that we are deity like Jesus was, don't get me wrong, but I will say that we are joint heirs of Jesus Christ. And I want to say this to us, is that God wants to speak over you and say, when you receive Jesus, I glorified you and I will glorify you again. And it will come by means of the devil, Satan himself, will be judged inside this world. And how's it going to happen? It is going to happen through the people of God who carry the glory of God. And how do we carry the glory of God? Because we invite the angel armies of the Lord to come in and back up everything we pursue for God. That's what it's all about. To believe God for more. And we can walk through Aspen and say, God, I pray, Lord, that you would release your angels' army over Aspen, God, and make a difference. I pray, God, that your angels would come and that you would clean the streets. I pray, God, that you would cause that the drug trade would not flourish in this place, God. I pray, Father, you would bind those things that bring immorality and tempt people to do things. I pray, Lord God, that you would come and release your angels to bind the enemy that comes against the church and against the people of God. I mean, just let's begin to think different. And if this is on YouTube, it's not just Aspen, okay? It's, can we pray that for Basalt? It needs a Carbondale, Marble, Redstone, Glenwood Springs. God, release your angel armies over the Roaring Fork Valley. And God, we believe that through our prayers, you will release what we are asking for by actual spiritual beings that are there on behalf of the heirs of salvation to fulfill our prayers. Amen. We can pray such things for schools, for city halls, For workplaces, God, release your angels. And I pray that wherever our feet would tread, the angel armies of the Lord would back up what we are, what we have been called to do. The devil's going to fall. That's what the Bible says. The devil's going to fall. I know that ultimately that day will come when he will be bound. And I'm not saying that we can make it happen across the earth, but I do believe that we can make a huge difference right here in this valley where we live.
Amen.
By people really beginning to ask God for great things. So as I look at this, I realize that God is saying to me, Jim, will you believe for greater things? I want to say this to you, is that this word was stirring in my heart and all week long. And it's merely because of the journey that the Lord is having me in right now personally. And I believe that God wanted in my heart and he wants to release in your heart that if you've been in process and you've been really wanting to serve the Lord and there are things that are stirring inside of your heart, then God took you through a season where he's just been dealing with sin. And he's just been saying to us, if I gave you all the power right now that it's going to take to fulfill your destiny with the amount of sin that's in your life, you could become an abuser of power. You could manipulate things that would not be right. And that somehow in that process, I think that we begin to embrace as though there is some kind of, I don't know how to say this, maybe limitation in the Lord and what he wants to do on our behalf. And we begin to interpret the future according to the feelings of ineffectiveness when we were in process. And that God then is just saying to us, I'm going to now release to you a revelation of all that I plan to do through your life and the release of the power of the kingdom of God. And I'm going to release you to do things that you didn't imagine that you could do before. Because I'll be with you. Did I lose you in that ramble?
No, we're good.
Yeah, you're good. Where are we?
God is going to conquer all.
What I want to just say to you is that I would want to just say to you today to be encouraged to live in the spirit of expectation. There is a new level of revelation that is going to come about the angels and the armies of God to back up everything that you want to do. And to reveal even new evidences of all that he wants to do through your life. Here's two things that I think angels do in the Bible when I read about it for individuals. The first thing that he does is that sometimes he even comes to them and gives them a word. That's not as common as we would like to see, but we find in the Bible that in dreams or in other means, angels would come and they would deliver the will of the Lord to people's hearts. He's done it before, he can do it again. The other thing that he did right here after this, when the angels were ascending and descending, we find out that the Lord actually, he was unmarried yet. And it says in the scripture there in Genesis that an angel would lead Rachel to the well and bring her into divine, Jacob into a divine appointment. I just want to say this to all of us here today. I think that if we begin to open up our eyes, we're going to be surprised how much angelic activity is already going on inside of our lives. And I just want to say this too. Look for, I'm not getting spooky. Look for divine appointments, open doors, and opportunities. Because you know who does that? Angels. I really believe that if you and I would begin just to walk through life with our eyes open and our ears open, we would see that God is going to have these things that we have labeled as being coincidences And help us to understand that in the life of the believer, there's divine appointments and not coincidences. God is going to have you run into people and meet people and hear them talk to each other. He's going to lead you into conversations where you say, I've been hearing that all week long, man. Everywhere I go, I keep hearing the same thing. What is that? That's the release of the kingdom of God and the power of God into people's that their own walk, and he's bringing them into our lives, and we just hear and we see things over and over again, and we don't even realize that God is just saying, man, I sent you so many words and so many messages and so many open doors and so many opportunities. And it's going to happen for you, right? So I just want to say, expect, let's live in an increased expectation of hearing from the Lord. Let's live with an expectation of just saying, God, wherever I go, the angels of the Lord are going before me and preparing the ground. If you and I begin to pray, I think that we're going to see, pray in faith, believing that that happens, we are going to be seeing more and more and more divine appointments. So today, you know what? I know my approach has been really more casual than usual, but I'm just sharing out of what's happened to me within the last week, and I just believe that what the Lord does in my heart is what he wants to do in the body of Christ and in the church. Why don't we all just stand up? I want to pray over all of you today, and I'm just going to pray for you, and I'm just thinking for a moment about where are you in this process concerning the will of God. Maybe you're in the cleansing process where God's getting things out that have to get out before he can bring you into the fullness of his plan. But also I believe that the reason the Holy Spirit stirred in my heart is that God wants to bring to your heart and to my heart an awakening of the armies of the Lord that are here to answer our prayers. With every head bowed and every eye closed, let me ask you something here today, and I'm going to give you a chance to respond. Are any of you feeling as though that God has placed something upon your heart to do, and yet it seems outside of the realm of the practical, outside of the realm of the real, outside of the realm of provision, outside of the realm of connections? You're saying, I don't even have connections. I have this big dream in my heart and no one even cares. And the people I'm thinking about, they don't even know I exist. And I don't even have those kind of things. But you're just saying, I want to reach out to the Lord today and say, God, I pray for the release of your angels in this situation, and that you're going to go to that person, you're going to go to that place, you're going to go to that opportunity, and you're going to set things up for me. And I'm going to today believe for greater things and ask you, Lord God, to release your angels in that situation. Would you lift up your hand? And I'm going to pray for you. See, I mean, we're all feeling this. Father, I just want to thank you, Lord, for the will that you have for each one of these people. I pray, Father, for the hope of the call that you place in their lives. I pray for the dreams, oh Lord God, that they have. And I declare today that, Lord, they are not impossible, but with God, all things are possible. And I'm praying, Lord God, that the angels of the Lord would come into each one of these homes, each one of these lives, Lord God. And that, Father, we just believe, Lord, right now, that our angels are beholding your face. And we're asking, God, that there would be a ladder over our lives, and that there would be angelic, a new release of angelic activity because of my faith and my expectation that, God, nothing for you is impossible, and that you are here to back up every one of my prayers. And so, Father, I just pray that for everyone that here that has their hand lifted up. And I pray also, Lord God, a greater awareness to see what you're doing, God. That when they go into situations, they're going to see divine appointments, opportunities and connections. And I also want to pray, Lord, for, because some of these dreams are 30 years old and 40. And you know, Lord, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter, Lord. We've been in process. And some of the things that you spoke to our hearts a long time ago are still going to work. They're work in our lives, God. So I pray, Father, bring together all the pieces of our lives. Bring together the good and the bad, the ugly and the beautiful. And let us see how it all comes together for good. because we're called according to your purpose. And we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing a song in closing today, and we'll be here in the front. Can I invite the elders and their wives to come on up here? If you need prayer today, we want to pray for you. But let me just say this. You can walk into this place, and you can walk out of here and never have an encounter with God. It's not meeting me. It's not listening to a sermon. It can have impact, but we're talking about a relationship with God. And I want to let everyone know here today that if you've never received Jesus Christ to come into your heart, he wants to come in today. I'm not talking about Christian religion. That won't work. I'm not talking about going to church. I'm talking about coming to the Lord and saying, Lord, I want to give you my heart. I want you to wash my sins away. I want you to cleanse me and remove guilt and any shame, any missed opportunities that alienated me from you. The Lord wants to touch you in a profound way today. And let Jesus come and move inside your heart. So as we're singing this song in closing, I just want to welcome anyone that's here today. Just step out wherever you're standing. Just step out and come forward to the front. Pam and I will be here in the front. You can come to any one of these people while we sing. And you're just saying, I want the Lord in my life. I want to know God. And he'll come and meet you here today. So Chad, you're going to lead us in a song. Thank you.